When does the festivity start?
I thought it was going to be on some
time. I know, it's kind of how it is.
Kind of
is.
But we don't have that right now. I'd like to introduce Elbert Guillory, state senator from Louisiana, and he made the famous video "Why I'm Republican." We're having technical difficulties, but he will now come out and tell you why he's still Republican. Senator Guillory. It was sad.
So I had to make that change. The Republican Party stands for the values of my community, of my parents, my church. If you take a look at education, most little Americans today cannot read, write, or compute at grade level. The Republican Party stands for education. Second Amendment. The Republican Party stands for permitting us to own weapons that will protect our families and our lives and our property.
Yes, sir.
Abortion. Almost a million babies killed in the womb every year. The only force fighting against that is the Republican Party. Getting people off government dependency and getting them to work. One force, and that's the Republican Party. There are three other things, three other topics that are threatening us right now. One of them is out of control federal spending. $20 trillion in debt. A lot of people forget, don't think about what happens when a government unit spins itself into bankruptcy. But you can ask Russia. 20 years ago, Russia was one of the two most powerful forces, political forces on earth. And then they spent themselves into bankruptcy. Military spending, mostly in Afghanistan. 20 years they were there. It took them 20 years to build themselves back up to a third or fourth rate nation. Ask Detroit. Ask the retirees in Detroit. And they have seen their pensions cut. The children of Detroit have seen their educations almost evaporate. The families of Detroit have seen their roads, their water, their hospitals become almost like third world countries. If we don't stand today and force these politicians to stop this out of control federal spending, your children, your grandchildren, and your great-grandchildren will be trying to bail themselves out of this debt. We must stop it. The Republican Party stands against that kind of spending. Another force that's threatening us is divisions. As smart as we are, as sharp as we are, we let charlatans come into our communities, come into our nation, and divide us. They come up with things like identity politics, Christian privilege, all police are racist. My favorite piece of political horse manure is white privilege. It is predicated on the concept that because 3% of white Americans hundreds of years ago owned slaves, that you are now benefiting still. The concept is that because a slave long ago picked the cotton of a long ago slave master, you are now living high on the hog. That is horse hockey. And it is demeaning to both of us. It's demeaning to you and to me. It says that your success is undeserved. And it says that my opportunity does not exist. I'm relegated to being a victim for several years. What they want to do is to make us like five weak separate fingers that just happen to be attached to the same hand instead of a united, powerful American fist. And there's one more. illegal immigration. The Republicans stand against illegal immigration. Right now, drugs brought across our border is a national scourge. There's a big problem with the jobs. Cheap, foreign, illegal labor is harming the families of America, many of the families of America. A lot of folks have been standing in line for a long time. Appalachian Americans, Irish Americans, Black Americans. It's not fair that someone would come and cut the line. We're giving, loving people, but we should take care of America and Americans first. So tonight, my fellow Americans, I ask that you stand against that crazy federal spending and stand with the Republican Party. I ask that you stand against the charlatans who come to divide us and stand with the Republican Party. I ask that you stand against illegal immigration and stand with the Republican Party. Thank you for having me. Good night.
Thank you, Senator Guillory. To have him, that kind of introduction and get us started off on this political season ahead of one of the great debates about the state of Georgia. With that, we'll continue along our agenda with the pledge. Will you please stand? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Now we'll start to introduce our moderator. Many of you know Kyle Wingfield as a journalist from the AJC, longtime journalist. Yeah, excellent. He's been with AJC for over 9 years and also has written for the Wall Street Journal. Mr. Kyle Wingfield, come to the stage.
Introduce each of the candidates one by one. They'll come and join me on the stage. I'm not going to go through their biographies. Those are in your program, and I want to have as much time as we can for them to speak tonight. So will you please join me in welcoming first David Belisle.
Thank you.
Buzz Brockway. Josh McKoon. And Brad Raffensperger. So first, we're all on the same page. Let me go over the rules tonight and the format. We will begin with opening statements by each candidate. They'll have 2 minutes. Then we will get into the Q&A, which I will begin. Each candidate will get 1 minute to respond. If they're mentioned by another candidate, at my discretion, we'll allow a 30-second rebuttal. I have a bunch of questions to go through. We're also going to take questions from the audience via some postcards, which are available over here. And out through the crowd, they'll be passing those around. Get them back to them, and they will get them to me. And we will mix those in as best we can. And then at the end, we will have 1 minute for closing remarks by each candidate. We do have a timekeeper here today, Ms. Miriam Corbin. Ms. Corbin, raise your hand. She'll be letting the candidates know when they're getting close to the end of their allotted time. The candidates at the halfway mark of your opening remarks and with 15 seconds left in your 1 minute answers. I believe with all that said, we'll go ahead and get started with our opening remarks. And we'll begin with Mr. Bill Otto.
Well, thank y'all. Thank y'all for coming out today for this and for the debate. Growing up in Gainesville, Georgia, and going to high school at North Hall High School, we also had a place where we had for theatrical and also musical performances in our high school. We called it the cafeteria. So this is amazing. So I go to North Point Community Church, and there was recently, this past Sunday, they were talking about the word anthem. And that's a word that we don't think of a lot. We also hear it with the national anthem quite a bit, but the meaning of the word anthem. And so as thinking of that word anthem, it means it's a poem or it's a song that basically inspires devotion for a certain group of people. When we talk about the national anthem, we're talking about land of the free, home of the brave. And I was thinking, if our campaign had an anthem, it would be to defeat voter fraud and champion Georgia jobs. And so, as we've gone across the state of Georgia, it's been amazing just meeting the people of the towns and the communities of the state of Georgia. I'm a sixth-generation Georgian. I am a pro-life, free-market Christian conservative. I'm a follower of Christ. I am a 20-year husband to an amazing wife, Candace. I've got 2 kids. I'm the father of a ballerina who's 13, and I'm a father of a Boy Scout who is now 15 and wanting to drive. So that's amazing. I grew up in Gainesville, Georgia. It is the poultry capital of the world. It says so in our water tower, so it has been confirmed. Most recently, I have been the mayor of Alpharetta in the best job I've ever had in my life. Not the highest paying, but the best job. To make Alpharetta the technology city of the South, and it's been my pleasure to run for the Secretary of State in what I consider the most irresistible state in these United States. And with your help, we would love to defeat voter fraud and champion Georgia jobs. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. I want to thank all of you for being here tonight. There's a lot of other things you could be doing tonight, but you're here to listen to the four of us who aspire to become the next Secretary of State of the state of Georgia. I want to thank the 6th District Republican Party for putting this event on and hosting us here. And I want to thank Kyle Wingfield for coming and asking what I'm sure will be wonderful questions. And I look forward to sharing with you some of my vision for the office of Secretary of State. You know, I've been active in the Republican Party now for 21 years. Started as a precinct captain, worked my way up, and from 2002 to 2005 was chairman of the Gwinnett County Republican Party. And that was a time when we were flipping the state. It was a Democratic stronghold, and during those years we flipped to a Republican state, and I was glad to play a small part of that. And you know, here we are 16 years later, And it kind of feels like the Republican leadership around this state is under assault. It's under threat. Democrats are energized. As I've traveled the state, I've seen that Democrats are meeting in places where President Trump got 75-80%. Now, they may have no shot, but they're still meeting. And they're energized, and they're going to come after us hard this year to try to, what they call, flip this state back. And I think we've got to work hard to make sure that doesn't happen. And I think how we do that is we re-articulate the conservative principles that we all share, and we carry a positive conservative vision to the people of Georgia of what conservative leadership can mean. As for Office of Secretary of State, two big things that I'm running on, obviously, our election integrity, making sure that we have that we work hard and have the best election system in America, and professional licensing. We have seen an economy that used to have 5% of the workforce that where people were required to have a professional license to almost a third, and that is over-regulation that we need to fight against and work on. And I look forward to sharing more questions with you as the evening goes on. Thank you.
Josh McKoon, your turn.
Good evening. My name is Josh McKoon. I'm running to be your next Secretary of State. My family has really been able to live what we think of as the American dream. My great-grandfather was a mill worker at the Eagle and Phoenix Textile Mill in Columbus, Georgia, in downtown Columbus, along the banks of the Chattahoochee River. My grandfather dropped out of school in the eighth grade to help take care of our family during the Depression. He served in World War II in the Pacific. He came home, he married my grandmother, who worked at commercial printers. They had a series of small businesses together, starting with a grocery store at Fifth Avenue and 8th Street in downtown Columbus. The last business they had was a laundromat they owned and operated. I remember refilling the Coca-Cola machine with my granddad. My dad was the first member of our family to go to college. Dad went on to law school, and he's practiced law for the last 40 years. And I followed in my dad's footsteps. I went to Furman University for my undergrad. Went to the University of Alabama for law school. They tell you to go ahead and get the bad news out of the way early in these things. I'm going to tell you that. And I was able to get elected to the state senate and serve the great people of the 29th district for 8 years. And I feel like for the average person, it's getting harder to achieve their American dream because of a government that's gotten too big and gotten in their way. And I think the purpose of those of us that seek elected office as Republicans is to get government out of the way. So I decided to run for Secretary of State. I had two big life changes. In the summer of 2015, my mother was diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer. She passed away 11 weeks to the day of her diagnosis. In August of 2016, I made the best decision of my life in marrying Jacqueline Bird. And those two decisions gave me a lot of pause about what I was doing with my life and the time I was spending. I was actually planning on taking a break from elected politics. And then some friends said, hey, you need to get in this race. We need an election lawyer with election law experience. We need somebody with a backbone to stand up to the left. So I'm running to be your Secretary of State to make Georgia the fastest state in the nation to get a job and the toughest state in the nation to cast an illegal vote. Thank you very much.
Good evening. My name is Brad Raffensperger. I'm running for Secretary of State to make sure that only Americans vote in our elections, and to make sure that Georgia is a great place to find a job and a great place to build a business. In both the City Council and also in the State House, I've always worked to protect taxpayers, homeowners, over-regulated businesses, life, and the Second Amendment. On a personal note, I met Trisha, my wife, for 41 years in high school. We got married halfway through engineering school, and we moved here in 1982 and lived in Gwinnett County for a long period of time. This is where we chose to raise our family. This is where we chose to build our businesses. And I'm committed to Georgia. I have a business, and right now we have two manufacturing plants. We have one in Columbus, Georgia. We have another one in Forsyth County. And from those two manufacturing facilities, we've worked on construction projects all over the country, in over 35 states and all over Georgia. And I then have now firsthand experience how some states make it easy to do business and other states make it hard. And as your next Secretary of State, I'm going to make it easy to do business in the state of Georgia. I am a licensed structural engineer, licensed general contractor. And I understand the importance why you want to streamline business regulations and licensing. That's very important. Obviously, elections is the lightning rod for this office. My commitment to you is to make sure that only American citizens vote in our elections. I believe that there's two things you never devalue. That's your currency and your citizenship. This is America, the best country in the whole wide world. When you become American, I hope you vote. So that's why I'm running for Secretary of State, to make sure that only Americans vote in our elections, to make sure that Georgia is a great place to build a business, and also a great place to find a job. Thank you very much.
All right, we've already heard about a range of the responsibilities that the Office of Secretary of State has. There are a number of roles, including being in charge of the state's boxing commission. I don't think we'll spend much time on that tonight. Although if you send me a card up here with a really good question, maybe. But the four major roles, when I think about this office, concern elections, corporations, professional licensing, and financial securities. So I'd like for each of you to tell us which of these areas you find most compelling in terms of why you got in this race and why that area is the one for you. And we'll start with Mr. Brockway this time.
I think all of them are very important. But I think the overriding one, the one that's most critical right now, is elections. And that's because the machines that we have reached the end of their life cycle. There are some counties that are concerned about their ability to properly conduct the 2020 presidential election. So we need to act promptly and deal with that. So I think that's the most important thing, because it's the most pressing. It's a big decision. It's a huge decision. Most of the country votes differently than we do. They allow paper ballots, hand-marked paper ballots, to be used. We don't do that here in Georgia. We have the DRE machines, and of course, I think that probably from a cost standpoint, from a security and a trust standpoint, we need to move to that system that other states are doing. Folks, unfortunately, across this country are losing trust in the electoral system, and if we lose trust in the electoral system, we've got really big problems in this country. So that needs to be addressed promptly. Thank you.
I would agree. Elections is certainly what got me in this race. You know, having an election background, and background in election law, I think is important. Secretary of State used to be a pretty sleepy office. And then we had an election in the year 2000 involving George W. Bush and Al Gore. And we had a lawsuit. We had Katherine Harris on television every night. And now the far left is trying to change Georgia election law, not at the state house, but at the courthouse. And so it's incredibly important to have someone with an election law background who understands how Georgia election law works. Last summer, I'm sure people in this room remember the John Ossoff-Kaaryn Handel election and the lawsuit filed by the far left to extend the voter registration window by an additional 60 days. We lost in federal court. A single federal judge said no, and we surrendered. That shouldn't happen. That's why there's an 11th Circuit Court of Appeals that comes to the election.
Didn't mention this earlier, but let's hold applause until the end so everyone can hear the entire answer. Likewise, let's just not have any of the negative response. So applause only and after the answer, please. Mr. Raffensperger.
I believe that elections is the most important office in the Secretary of State's office because it touches 100% of American citizens. Not everyone is a business owner, not everyone has a business license, but if you're an American, elections are number one. My number one job is voter protection. Your priceless franchise should never be taken from you. Therefore, we need to make sure that we have a solid process for absentee voting and solid process for people when actually at the top of the funnel when they get registered to vote. Elections is our number one concern, and that's what I'm going to fight for. Thank you.
Surprise, surprise, yes, elections. But here's the thing, the integrity of our country starts with the integrity of our elections. And right now we have some gaping holes. One is, we talk a lot about machines, and I'm sure we'll get to that later tonight, but the biggest hole is the absentee ballot. Right now you present a photo ID when you go to vote in person, whether it's early voting or whether it's on election day like I like to do. But if you vote absentee, you do not need a photo ID. You don't need a witness, you don't need a notary, and you don't need an excuse. All you need is somebody's stamp and somebody's address, and that is the biggest hole for voter fraud. The other one is on U.S. citizens. Now, we're all saying, well, U.S. citizens shouldn't vote, but here's the biggest thing, and we're the only ones talking about it. Right now, in Georgia, you can vote in U.S. elections even if you're not a citizen. All you have to do on the voter registration form is click the box that says you have neither a driver's license number nor a social security number. If you complete the rest of the form, you will be registered to vote whether you are a U.S. citizen or not, and it has to stop.
All right, I thought elections might take most of that, so I do want to make sure we hear about the other areas that the office governs. So starting with Mr. McKoon, now let's hear the one or two highest priorities for you in each of the other three areas that you didn't address. And since you all did elections, I'll just say that those three areas for all of you will be corporations, professional licensing, and financial securities.
So I would start off with licensing. You heard earlier tonight the explosion of licensing that's occurred. Licensing is important for public health and public safety reasons, but if we stop issuing licenses to librarians tomorrow in this state, we would not create a public health and public safety crisis. We have to cut red tape and get government out of the way so people can achieve their own American dream. A cosmetology license holder in this state spends on average 350 days in training, while an EMT license holder spends 31 days in training. There's something profoundly wrong with a system where it requires 10 times the training to get a license to cut and color hair and do nails as it does to render life-saving aid in the event of a medical emergency. On corporations, we need to work on customer service, improving the experience for businesses, giving them a predictable time frame that paperwork will be turned around. And on securities, frankly, we need more resources to do the job, and I'll be making that case to the General Assembly. Thank you.
Mr. Raffensperger.
The other three departments are very important. Security is actually typically overlooked by many people. We don't have a very large securities industry in Georgia. I think one of the ways that we could actually increase that very quickly is eliminate the state income tax and go to the fair tax. The General Assembly this past year, we have 2019, your state income tax will drop to 5.75 and then to 5.5. But when you look at, you're trying to compete with Texas and Florida, that does put us at a disadvantage. The other thing is, out there in the financial world, there's this perception that we want to attract the Amazons, the Mercedes, and the Porsches. And we don't seem to want to go after the finance folks. It'd be very important if we started throwing out the welcome mat for them, because I think that would be good for growth. Because when they come here, it's always going to then help us develop our IT and our tech sector, when you have financing here in place. So I think that's something we need to take a look at. Thank you.
Rather than try to cram in 2 minutes something on corporations, securities, licensing, and charities, what I'm going to talk about is the other side of the job. As mayor of Alpharetta, there are the direct responsibilities of that job. It's public safety, it's roads, it's parks and rec, it's all the things you know and you're familiar with. But the things that we did best and the things I'm most proud about in Alpharetta is the other side of the job, which is this leadership side. What we were able to do in Alpharetta by leading leaders, by engaging our key industry of technology, we were able to create the state's first technology commission. We landed a technical college. We were able to launch an incubator, which now serves 50 startup technology companies. We made the case for a conference center. And we grew the city of Alpharetta to over 640 technology companies and over 100,000 jobs. Putting the mayor's hat on for a moment, the Secretary of State's office, in our key industries, agriculture, technology, and logistics, we want to apply that model to the entire state. Thank you.
You can clap when they finish. I just wait till they finish. I wish my kids listened as well. Okay, Mr. Brown.
Well, yeah, for me, the second most important thing, the urgent thing that is going on in the Secretary of State's office is professional licensing. As I mentioned earlier, we've gone from an economy where only 5% of the workforce needed a professional license to now almost 30% of the workforce needs some sort of permission from the government in order to start a job. And there's an entity in state government that's supposed to be taking a look at this called the Georgia Occupational Regulatory Review Council. And I discovered last year that they weren't doing this. They weren't performing these periodic reviews that they're supposed to be of each licensing board and what the regulations are. So I drafted a resolution. We were able to get that passed in the House this year to draw attention to it, and we started to see some results. We blocked a bill this year that would have increased the requirements for massage therapists to make it harder for these folks to get into this profession. And we need to continue to work on this. We need to work on this every day and make sure that we have the proper amount of regulation on each of these professions and not too much, so that folks can who are qualified can get out there and support their families and make a living.
Okay, so let's do spend some time digging down on elections. The biggest spotlight in recent weeks, and there were some allusions to this earlier, it's been on the kind of voting system Georgia should have. Everyone seems to agree it's time for a change, but they don't necessarily agree on what kind of change. So let's start with Senate Bill 403, which died at the end of this year's legislative session. Where did you stand on that bill, and what did you think was wrong or right about it? And we'll start with Mr. Raffensperger.
As I went out and I've been visiting all four corners of the state of Georgia, I've said that we really need to look at updating our voting machines. The reason we need to do that is these current machines were brought into service in 2002 under Secretary of State Kathy Cox. That's 16 years ago. And many of you probably have in your hip pocket right now an iPhone X. And just think about that. In the 10 years that Siri has developed into a beautiful young child, she is now 10 years old and she's up on her 10th generation. So we're still using that same technology with our voting machines, so we need to update that. I believe that we need a voting machine that's updated for the next generation, which has a verifiable paper trail. The DREs that we're using right now do not have a verifiable paper trail. The system that was used in the city of Conyers was electronic at the front end, but you pressed a little button, it was to print the ballot, then you could look at it, and then you could have it scanned. And therefore, you had belts and suspenders to make sure you have a paper trail. Thank you.
Well, the system that I would advocate is a system essentially where you would go to the polls, you show your photo ID, you would be given essentially a piece of cardstock, and you would go to the voting machine just like you go now. You then vote electronically just like you do now, but when you hit cast ballot, it would actually print out that selection onto that piece of cardstock. You would have the opportunity to visually verify that the vote you just electronically stated is actually represented on that card. Then you would take that card and you would submit that to a second machine, which would do two things. A, it would make a photograph or a scan of that physical ballot, but it would also store that physical ballot. And in that way, you have actually three records of each and every vote. One electronic copy, one scanned copy, and a physical copy. Better voter security, better voter confidence. Thank you.
Senate Bill 403, of course, was introduced in the Senate, and it passed the Senate with strong bipartisan support. I think there was only one dissenting vote. Unfortunately, as the debate moved forward, the bipartisan consensus fell apart. And by the time at the end of the session when the bill eventually died, there was no bipartisan support on that bill. And there were a lot of folks weighing in on this bill and some with ideas and some with other ideas. And so at the end, what we switched and attempted to do was to form a commission that would allow the state to step back, bring a panel of experts together, and sit down and talk about this and say, okay, what's going on out in the rest of the country, and what do we need to do, and what should Georgia do? In the end, it was about 11:30 on sine die, and it just couldn't get it done. But I've proposed, if I'm elected Secretary of State, that's what I'll do. I'll put a commission together, a bipartisan commission that would take a look at this and recommend to the legislature what system we need. I don't want to prejudge what that is, but we need to have some experts together to get smart people together to figure out what that is and recommend it to Georgia.
I think Senate Bill 403 was about what kind of technology we're going to migrate to, and so what I would say to you is we need an open and transparent process. A competitive bid process. We're talking about millions and millions of dollars of your money. We need to make sure that certain guidelines are set. And I think you've heard it from several of the candidates here tonight. We need a paper trail as part of whatever system we migrate to that can be independently audited and verified. I do think it's very important to include local elections officials in the discussion about what kind of technology we move to, because the Secretary of State may stand on top of and oversee elections administration, but when we have a statewide election in this state, what we really have are 159 county level elections. And so it's very important that we bring all the stakeholders into the process as an open, transparent, competitively bid process moves us into new technology that gives voters greater confidence in the result of our elections.
As we talk about the kind of technology that would be used in a new voting system, much of the concern that I picked up on from the public seems to center on the potential use of a barcode and the possibility that voters would not be able to verify that the information embedded in that correctly reflects their choices. So a pretty simple question, and we'll start with Mr. Belisle. Should those type of systems be legal?
This could be a very short answer, but you know, the system that I just described has a visual verification. In other words, you're looking at the person I just voted for State House is this person. The person I voted for Superior Court Judge is this person. I do not believe a barcode helps that situation. In fact, I think it hurts because there are two things we're trying to get across and figure out and make better. It's not just voter security, although that's the first. It's also voter confidence. And I think voter security and voter confidence are helped by having that system that is visually verified, scanned, and stored without the use of the barcode.
One of the things that we heard as this debate went on during the legislative session about Senate Bill 403 was about this barcoding system. And some folks had, out of state had recommended to me that I talk to a professor at Georgia Tech. So I reached out to him and I talked to him just the other day. Dr. DeMilo, or Professor DeMilo at Georgia Tech. And one of the things he said, well, anytime you introduce a new item, a new technology into a system, it creates all sorts of unforeseen security hazards. So I think my question would be, why do we need a barcode in these machines? It seems that several of the machine manufacturers now include this in the machines that they sell. And so the question that I want to find out is why? Why did they do that? I'm not satisfied right now that that's a necessary part of the system. And so right now, you know, whether we should ban it in law and forbid it in law, I'm not ready to say that yet, but I am concerned about why those are now part of the machines.
The language of Senate Bill 403 as it passed the Senate was amended in committee in negotiation with elections integrity activists to include specific language saying that the ballot must be something that can be visually confirmed by the voter, that is readable by a human being. That's the position that the state Senate took. It's what I voted for. That's my position on this issue. Thank you.
I believe it's not really necessary to have a barcode if we already have a little square box that's been filled in for your all the other spots, all the positions that you're voting for. So it just seems redundant. And so if you already are going to have people able to read their ballot and it shows who you want for governor, who you want for lieutenant governor, all the other county commissioners, then why do you need a barcode? So I don't think it's necessary. And so if you could show me a reason why it's necessary, then I'd be open to considering that. But at the present time, I don't see why it would be necessary. If anything, it could be confusing and misleading. And so I think we just keep with what we have, with the square box filled in for who you're voting for. Thank you.
Okay. We talk about how a lot of the implementation of this on the ground is going to be made by local governments. And so a question, should there be a statewide uniform voting system for consistency's sake, or should there be some room for counties to have more flexibility to obtain the voting system that best fits their needs within certain parameters? And Mr. Brockway, you'll be first on this
one. I would prefer a uniform voting system across the state. I think that's one thing that has worked well for us these last 15 years or so that we've had the DRE machines. Voters are able to understand that, whether they live, no matter where they live or move in the state of Georgia. So I think a uniform voting system would be preferable.
I think that you do need to go with a uniform voting system. I think if you don't do that, you're frankly inviting a lawsuit, because if you have people using different methods to elect folks in a statewide election, I think that you could very well see some of these far left groups that have been suing on other bases sue on that basis. So we need a decision-making process that includes the local governments, because it's a lot different running an election in Cobb County than it is running an election in Stewart County. So we need that input, but we ought to have a statewide solution.
I believe in uniformity in the election system that we use. I believe that we're one Georgia and we're all Georgians, and so I just think it should be a uniform system. I do believe that we need to reach out and make sure that we have the county election supervisors from the smallest county to the largest counties engage in the process when you pick our election systems. So it's something that works for all counties of all sizes. Thank you.
I believe there should be uniformity inside the state of Georgia, but I want to take this opportunity to say there should be diversity outside the state of Georgia. There's been a lot of talk recently about taking systems in one state and putting them under central authority, having central systems across all the states of the United States. I want to take this opportunity to say I oppose that. Part of the strength of our election integrity is the diversity from state to state to state. That being said, the best way to make sure that we have the best voter security and the best voter confidence is to have a system that's uniform from county to county, from Clinch County to Hall County to Hart County.
We could talk about this issue all night. We're not going to. I've received a lot of questions sent to me once, you know, through the publicity that I was going to be moderating this debate. And trust me, if we still have time, I have more questions on this topic that if we don't have anything else to talk about, we will. But I'd like to move on. We're not going to leave elections specifically yet, though, just the part about the voting system. This is a little bit broader question. What about hacking? How should Georgia protect its election server, as well as the voting machines, from possible intrusions? And that would be Mr. McKoon first.
Well, I think the discussion about hacking and cybersecurity generally is an important one as we move to a new elections technology. I think what's really important is how these elections machines communicate with each other. There are some solutions out there that involve communication between the precinct and the central polling station. And if you allow these machines to be connected on a broader network, I think you're inviting some risks. So as we go through that process of deciding what technology to migrate to, it's going to be important to have cybersecurity experts at the table to minimize the risk of hacking whatever system we move to moving forward.
Currently, the voting machines aren't connected to the internet, and that's a good thing. And I'd like to see us continue that same process, because that's where you're going to have the biggest potential for someone hacking into the system. I'm more concerned about your confidential voting records, confidential voting information, who you are. Right now, the Social Security numbers are encrypted, only the last four numbers show. But I think that we need to consider other measures. You think about with Bitcoin and with blockchain technology, you know, what that is doing, and actually a very secure technology. There's other technologies out there. We have to just be mindful that hackers never sleep, and nor can we. They just broke into the city of Atlanta. They got into one of the top, there's only three security or credit reporting agencies, and they broke into that, and over 150 million Social Security numbers were launched out on the internet. So we have to recognize what we're up against. Thank you.
The city of Alpharetta has made many companies very prosperous by growing in technology and having the latest in technology, including cybersecurity. And so I'm a big believer in making sure we stay ahead of the curve, not behind it. I do think the recent move to move our data, voter data, inside the Secretary of State's office as opposed to being with Kennesaw State, and against Kennesaw State. But if the buck's going to stop here, then the Secretary of State needs to be responsible all the way down for that data security So I believe in closed circuit data storage. I do think we need to explore blockchain technology and figure out whether that's a good fit for Georgia, but we have the opportunity and the obligation, I think, to stay ahead of the curve and not behind the curve when it comes to data security.
I read the after-action report of the hack, or data breach at Kennesaw State, and I was kind of shocked, quite frankly. There weren't even locks on the doors where the servers were stored. So the decision was correct to bring that in-house. But look, we have in the state of Georgia, and you may not know this, almost most credit card transactions are processed by companies right here in Georgia. We also have down in Augusta the Cyber Command of the Department of Defense. There are an enormous number of cybersecurity experts right here in the state of Georgia, and we'd be foolish not to work with them and say, all right, what can we learn and how can we apply that to what we have here in Georgia? If you saw 60 Minutes the other night, it's pretty clear. I know people don't want to talk about it, but it's pretty clear that the Russians were trying to penetrate various systems. They were able to do so in Illinois, and they didn't, thankfully, in Georgia, but we've got to be on guard to make sure that doesn't happen here. We've got to bring experts to the table to make sure that doesn't happen.
Okay, let's move to a longer-running concern, perhaps, and that would be voter fraud. I'd like to know how extensive you believe this problem is in Georgia, and how do you propose we solve it? And Mr. Raffensperger, have the first shot at it.
It's very difficult to tell how much voter fraud you have when you have a very small investigation department in the Secretary of State's office. But what I would say is I think the biggest potential of voter fraud is in the absentee ballot process. Currently, state law only allows you to assist someone for absentee up to 10 people, but federal, it's unlimited. And that's where, you know, the camel's nose got underneath the tent. And so you have these issues. You have people actually registering 200 people, many of them sleeping in a senior home, that have suffered from dementia and Alzheimer's. And that's been found out. And in Northwest Georgia, people were found and charged with voter fraud, and it goes back to the absentee process. So that's the area that we really need to dig into the closest, because that's where the most voter fraud is happening. Thank you.
You don't have to know how much water is in this bottle to know if there's a hole in it. It's got to be plugged. And I think when it comes to voter fraud, that's always the defense. It's like, well, you don't know how much voter fraud's happening. Who cares? There shouldn't be any voter fraud taking place. And I believe that we've got some gaping holes. The absentee ballot I mentioned a moment ago, no photo ID requirement for the absentee ballot. There's no witness, no notary, no excuses needed. That's got to be plugged. The other item is voting by illegal aliens, by those who are not residents, who are not citizens, of our country. Right now, I briefly mentioned it a moment ago, but in block 5 of the voter registration form, all you have to do is click the box that says you have neither a driver's license number nor a social security number. If you check that box, if you fill out the rest of the form, you will be registered to vote whether you are a citizen or not. That needs to stop if we're going to stop voter fraud. Thank you.
The best way to stop voter fraud is to continue to enforce our photo ID requirement that we have and to keep the voter list clean. And unfortunately, we've been challenged in Georgia. There's a number of lawsuits going on right now to try to prevent us from keeping our voter list clean. Georgia is part of a consortium of 30 states led by Kansas where we compare voter lists on a periodic basis to look and see, did people move? We need to continue to do that. I was able to get a law passed in Georgia to allow local elections officials to look through the obituaries and start the process of removing a person who's deceased from the ballot. We've got to continue to do that. There's another group called ERIC that also compares voter lists against the Social Security death records. So we've got to be diligent with that. It has to be an ongoing process to keep that voter list clean. You do that, you enforce photo ID, you keep your voter list clean so that only citizens are on that list, and you're going to stop most fraud.
Four years ago in my home county, we had a lady come to the elections office with an envelope containing 19 absentee ballots. And she was asked by the Republican member of the Board of Elections, what are you doing turning in these 19 absentee ballot. She said, well, I work in a local nursing home and I'm doing this as a service to the residents. The Board of Elections conducted an investigation and found 15 of those 19 residents were so unwell that they could not sign their name or make their mark. But someone prepared those applications. Someone voted those ballots. It's vitally important that we enforce the law. Now, they clearly found out this was going on and that a violation had occurred, but there was no criminal investigation, no one was prosecuted, no one went to jail. Why is that? Because we don't have enough sworn law enforcement officers in the Secretary of State's office enforcing the law. If we suddenly reduce the number of state troopers around our state to two or three, we would not say that we had solved the speeding problem. We would say we have an enforcement problem. And that's what we have when it comes to voter fraud. And that's the solution, more enforcement.
We do have a drill down on this topic that comes from the audience, talking about illegal voting. How do you propose to prevent and or expose those who are registered to vote who are not citizens, specifically? Mr. Bellot.
Well, I wish I'd known that question was coming. I'm going to save some space. But with respect to the illegal aliens being able to vote in U.S. elections, we need to enforce the Proof of Citizenship Act that was passed by the state legislature in 2010. And that actually is the solution to what I told you a moment ago with that checking the box and being registered to vote whether you're a U.S. citizen or not. There's a Proof of Citizenship Act that once implemented would require that once you fill out that voter registration form that you would have to prove your citizenship. But today, 8 years after it was passed, we have yet to implement the Proof of Citizenship Act. We need to do it.
There are, in law right now, a number of processes that the Secretary of State's office has to go through when they receive somebody registering to vote. They check the citizenship is one of the things they check, and they check that out. There's a several step verification. So we need to continue to do that. As I mentioned before, we need to be very diligent on keeping the voter list clean. But I think there's some other things we could probably do. And I think one thing that would help them enormously would be the if Washington could fix this issue with the Dreamers, because a lot of those folks have driver's licenses now, and when you dump that number of people in the system, inevitably somebody's going to slip through, no matter how diligent you might be. So I think Washington could help us there. The real ID system that we have with driver's licenses, it's a pain in the neck for all of us to go and get our driver's license renewed, but it really helps when it comes to this issue of registering to vote. Thank you.
Georgia Department of Driver Services has issued over 48,000 driver's licenses and identity cards to illegal aliens with deferred action. We have been working very hard in the legislature to try to address this problem because the license they receive is virtually indistinguishable from the license that you and I have. So at a minimum, if we're going to issue driver's licenses to illegal aliens, if we're going to do that, then we at least need to distinguish the driver's license. We actually passed a bill out of the Senate Public Safety Committee this year on that topic. If you elect me your Secretary of State, part of our legislative program in 2019 is going to be finally solving the problem of distinguishing the driver's license and identity card that's issued to an illegal alien. If we're going to do that, let's at least make it clear there's a difference. If we can't get that through the legislature, we're going to take the limited term driver's license database and go to every one of the 159 counties and look to purge the list. That's what we're going to do to solve this problem.
Those are all great ideas. I guess it was two sessions ago that in the House we had a bill that was going to put on the top of the driver's license. I was one of the top signers. I thought it was a great idea. Some other folks didn't, but on the top of the driver's license, it was going to say the word non-citizens. If you're a non-citizen, I could just tell them that you can't vote because we don't want people showing up. This year, the Senate had a bill that got through the Senate and didn't get through on the House side. I did notice, though, in North Carolina that what they have is a little pink border on the top, and what it says is not lawful or no lawful status. If that's too strong for some people's Metro Atlantic sensibilities, then I would prefer maybe we just go with light green and then have words like not valid for voting. But then it's a pretty simple marker that people know that they're not a citizen, but it's not saying that they're legal or illegal. They could be someone from France, they could be from Germany, here from Mercedes. But if you went over to Germany and you thought you were going to vote in an election, you know you would never try that. And I think a Mercedes executive is never going to do that either. So I think that would be a great step. Thank you.
All right, another question from the audience for those trying to keep from voting, to those you want to help facilitate the voting. How will you improve the voter registration and absentee voting processes for those who are serving our country away from home? Presumably they mean overseas. And Mr. Brockway, that's up first.
Yeah, the reason we have this brutal two-month-long runoff that we'll probably experience in this race too is because of a settlement with the Department of Justice that requires us to do so because of military and overseas ballots. They're required to be available for 45 days. But there's a couple of states that avoided that, and that was Alabama and South Carolina, most notably our two neighbors, because they implemented preferential voting for military and overseas ballots. I think we can do that, speed up that process, that will help those voters. I also think we can probably make some improvements to technology to make it easier to access for folks who are overseas and serving our country or just overseas on business. So there's a couple of things we can do that would really help.
Last year, while all of you were suffering through the nine-week runoff in the 6th congressional district election, South Carolina had a special election for Congress. Their runoff lasted 2 weeks because they figured this problem out. They have a secure channel for military and overseas voting. This is an issue that I brought to the attention of the Secretary of State's office back in 2013. Again, having a lawyer with a background in election law who understands what the Federal Move Act means and how it's going to interact with our state law is important. That's an important qualification for the person that's going to hold this office. So we absolutely need to convene the stakeholders here, not only our active military, but our veterans, our retired military, to look at ways to make it easier, better for them, but also better for the entire process by giving the legislature control again over our election schedule instead of ceding it to a federal judge.
When we were in session a few months ago, this company, a technology company, was showing what they had for absentee overseas military ballots. I found it very interesting. I just started getting some information about it, so I'm not really ready to take a position on it, but that's something that I think I would like to explore that with the General Assembly, look at how we could speed up that process. I think that South Carolina should be commended for being able to do that in 2 weeks, because if you speed up the process, I think it's just going to be a whole lot less pain for everyone else. So I think that's a good step, what they've done, and perhaps this updated technology that is being used in other states right now. Thank you.
If we could do secure early voting for the entire state of Georgia, certainly we could do secure voting for those of our men and women who are in the military. The answer does lie in technology, and I think we need to we owe it to them, those who are serving us, who are up to their full life, to get the most secure way to make it convenient for them to vote and make sure it's secure, and I do believe that we have the technology to do that. Thank you.
Okay, so I mentioned that there's lots of stuff besides elections, and I'm guilty of only asking you questions about elections so far, so I apologize for that. Let's totally move on from that, and let's get the licensing. Several of you mentioned that earlier on, but each of you, let's hear what are some specific proposals that you have regarding licensing, whether it's more, less, different, changing it, whatever it might be. And Mr. McKoon, you have the first.
So there are two proposals I would make. One would be to go through each one of the 41 licensing boards and ask two questions. Is this a job that should require a permission slip from the government that you pay for to do? And let's answer that question yes or no. If the answer is yes, we do need that permission slip, then let's see how we can use apprenticeships, let's see how we can do other things to streamline the process to more rapidly connect people to the dignity of honest hard work. That's the first proposal. The second proposal is to solve our regulatory bottleneck in the office. We have 170,000 licensed nurses in the state. Right now, 550 open complaints. They're taking, on average, 400 days to investigate. That is unacceptable. But it's because the licensing fees paid by the license holders do not go to the licensing boards. They go to the general fund to be appropriated by the legislature. That's why I would bring forward a constitutional amendment that you would be able to vote on to dedicate that every one of those dollars goes to the service that it's intended to be paid for.
As a licensed civil engineer, I'm licensed in over 30 states, and I have reciprocity with all these other states. So I wrote the exam here in Georgia, and then I used that for reciprocity. So we think we need to have more reciprocity with other states, particularly for veterans or veteran spouses. Because when they move in here, all of a sudden, their spouse can't practice her profession, be it nursing or being it as an engineer, whatever it is. I think we also need to take a look in the House, pass the resolution, a study committee to look at what licensing do we really need. Because at the end of the day, it's very important for some professions to be licensed. I believe that engineers should be, not because of an engineer, because if you make a mistake and a building collapses, people die. But other things that may not be very important. It's not just a question of public safety. And what we don't ever want to do is create a barrier for some young person that wants to start and diversify their career, or some person who's been outsourced or downsized because of corporate restructuring when they're 50 or 55 to start a new career. And so we want to make sure those doors are open for them. Thank you.
The litmus test on professional licensing is this. Is that board designed to protect the public? Or is it designed to protect the profession? And I think that's what needs to be applied as we try to figure out, okay, which licenses are important to be, those boards important to be managed by the Secretary of State's office, and which ones are not. But here's the truth about the Secretary of State's office. It is a hat-in-hand position. There's very little authority, and there's very little resources in that office. Nobody on this stage, if they're elected as Secretary of State, can change the number of licensing boards with policies. The boards are determined by the state legislature. The members of those boards are appointed by the governor. And so if we're going to try to start changing how the Secretary of State's office, we're going to need your help. We're going to need the legislature's help. But right now, the funds that are coming to the Secretary of State's office are barely enough to do those constitutional duties. It sounds to me a lot like mayor. There's very little authority. There's very little resources. That's why we believe we need to be qualified to do just that.
Yeah, I think two things that I would focus on. I mentioned it before, the Georgia Occupation Regulation Review Council is supposed to perform periodic reviews with each licensing board to find out, does this profession need to be licensed at all? And what are the regulations on it? They're not doing that. The Secretary of State is a member of that commission. And so I can assure you, if I'm Secretary of State, we'll be doing that. We'll take that information to the legislature. And I can tell you in the House, there are a number of my colleagues, soon to be former colleagues, who are itching to bite into that and to deal with this to make sure we're not over-regulating. The second thing is, Senator McKoon mentioned fees. He's exactly right. Unfortunately, we had a resolution, House Resolution 158, a constitutional amendment that would have allowed us to dedicate fees to the Secretary of State's office, but it never even it was brought up for a vote in the Senate. So we've got to have, this has to change. Fees have to go to what they're supposed to go for, not just in the Secretary of State's office, but every fee in state government. So we've got to work on that.
Corporate registration is one of the main ways Georgians interact with the Secretary of State's office. How can the office improve that experience for Georgia's business owners? And Mr. Raffensperger, you first.
Two sessions ago, I introduced House Bill 87, which would allow a corporation to renew their corporation for up to 3 years, business owner's choice. When that bill was originally written, I had the word shall. I also had discounts for the second and third year. Went through the committee process, I took my half a loaf, I didn't get my discounts, and the word was changed from shall to may. And I understand it's a complicated change in their software, but that didn't go into effect this past January. As Secretary of State, I'll make sure that goes into place. I also had a bill this session that was going to waive for a veteran-owned corporation in and the former corporation in Georgia, honorably discharged, Georgia domicile, waived their fee for 3 years performing a corporation in Georgia. The purpose I did that is, first of all, to tell the folks up in the Pentagon that Georgia's veteran friendly, but also, when your veteran gets out, that he'll stay in Georgia and create a business for himself, but also for all Georgians. Thank you.
I work with the Corporations Division in my day job on a daily basis, and what we the type of turnaround, there's different levels of expedite fees. And right now, for the highest expedite fee, the level of turnaround is what we used to get just as a matter of course when you file for a new company. And part of the reason for that is, as I mentioned before, the Secretary of State's office being a hat-in-hand position. What has happened is those expedite fees are now actually covering the funding gap just to run the corporation's division. And so there's a lot of money that goes to the Secretary of State's office, and a lot of that money needs to stay with the Secretary of State's office so it can do the constitutional duties that it has. But the reason for the delay in terms of a company being filed is because they need those expedite fees just to make ends meet. So that's got to change.
Yeah, it just gripes me that business owners in this state or people who want to start a business have to pay an expedite fee to let the government give them permission to get into business. That just irks me, and it's gonna change if I'm Secretary of State. We're gonna make it happen. Resources, as you've heard mentioned several times, it is a problem in the Secretary of State's office. It generates about $90 million of income. It receives about $30 million to run the operations, all the operations, so that has to change. We've heard some proposals to do that. I certainly support that, a constitutional amendment. But look, relationships are incredibly important in politics. We do have to work with the legislature when they're in this position. And I've got a good relationship with the members of the legislature, and I can work hard and I can get that done and get these things accomplished. I'm not going to have to go in there and knock heads around. We're going to have a cooperative relationship. So I think it's incredibly important that we do this. We are proud that we're the best state in America to do business in. But if we're not also the easiest, then we've got a problem and we're not really the best.
There are really, I think, two parts of this issue. Number one is we need to have posted expectations of when you file something, when you can expect to get it back. I was speaking to a businessman yesterday who's been waiting 4 weeks for an amended filing to come back to his office with no explanation. He overnighted the check, overnighted the documents, can't get any result. On behalf of my own clients, I've had situations where I've paid the expedite fee and not gotten the documentation back in time. And then I filed under the regular process with the regular fee and got it early. So there are clearly both some expectation setting that needs to be done and also some management issues to make sure that we meet those deadlines. I mean, that's the way you run a business. That's what you should expect from the government. We tried to do that with Senate Bill 2 over the last 2 years with local governments on permitting and licensing to provide folks with some level of predictability on what to expect from the government. They ought to expect that from the Secretary of State.
Another question from the audience here. What is the most critical issue regarding the monitoring of financial securities, and how would you resolve it? Mr. Belle, it's your turn to go first.
Yeah, the biggest thing, so everyone knows that there is the SEC at the federal level, but there's also the Georgia Securities, which is managed through the Secretary of State's office. Recently, the Invest Georgia exemption was expanded from a $1 million investment to a $5 million investment. Let me just tell you where that comes down and where that actually impacts our state. Right now, technology is one of the things that our state does best, but the future of technology is going to depend on our ability to attract venture capital into our state. And right now, three very blue states, California, Massachusetts, and New York, get 75% of all investment dollars in terms of venture capital for technology. If Georgia is going to lead on technology, we've got to work with our departments to make it easier to invest in Georgia companies, easier to invest Georgia dollars in those Georgia companies. Thank you.
Yeah, this is one of the areas where it's great to not be a lawyer, because then I can go hire great lawyers. And we've got two of them on stage, so I might maybe after the election. But this is a crucially important topic. It really is. We mentioned before, we consider ourselves, we've been judged to be the best state in America to do business in. And part of that is that we need to be able to, people need to be allowed to invest securely. So we've got to work on that. I think that part of the Secretary of State's office is managed very well right now, but like most of it, it probably needs some more resources to pour into that to make sure we're doing it right, making sure it's easy for folks in the state of Georgia to handle securities.
I think the number one issue when it comes to the securities division from folks I've spoken to who previously worked in that division, the Secretary of State's office, is making sure that it is adequately resourced and that it has what it needs in the budget process to do the mission that it has been assigned. I think right now, out of all the departments in the Secretary of State's office, it is the one in most need of additional financial resources to be able to adequately function in its regulatory role. And so, from my perspective, that's really the number one job there in the securities area, is to go to the legislature through the appropriations process and get the resources necessary to do that job.
I've listened tonight and I've heard everyone tell us how the tale of what the Secretary of State's office, that license fees and corporation fees are $80 million a year, and the office only gets $30 million. I'm a business owner, and I've learned how to do more with less. I think the Secretary of State's office just needs to suck it up and understand that's what the situation is. And in fact, if we ever got dedicated fees, I don't know if I'd grow the department. Actually, what I would do is lower the corporation fees and lower your licensing fees and return the money back to the taxpayers, back to the business people. That's what we need to do. As it relates to securities, if people are doing things that aren't right and we get a complaint, we act on it, we investigate, and then we prosecute, we strip their license, and we run them out of Georgia. Thank you.
Okay, so squeeze in one more question before we get to the closing statements. Just taking account of all the office's duties, how would you say the office has been doing to help foster a strong economic climate in Georgia? And how could it do better? And Mr. Brockway, you get it first.
I mentioned before, it's not just a trite phrase with me. Where the Secretary of State can really help Georgia in economic development is making it extremely easy for you to start your business, to renew your business, your corporate papers, to get your professional license if you're qualified. That's where the Secretary of State can really help our economy grow. And I think that we can do that through the application of technology. We can do that through solid management and working on all these things that that the Secretary of State's office is charged to do. I'm not looking to expand the Office of Secretary of State. I'm not looking to change its mission statement. It has certain specific duties that it's required to do by our Constitution. It's kind of boring. I'm a nerd. I went to Georgia Tech. I'm a nerd. That stuff looks exciting to me. Figuring out how to make it quicker and easier for you to start your business and get in business excites me, and that's the kind of thing I want to work on every day.
I think the best thing the next Secretary of State can do in terms of economic development within the office comes under the area of professional licensing. We have several licenses. I mentioned the cosmetology license earlier, where we are disqualifying people from even going down the road of trying to get that license because of the cost involved, the time that's involved. And yes, when there are public health or public safety reasons for that training ought to remain in place. But when there's not, you know, we ought to be working, that ought to be the thing that gets you up in the morning in the Secretary of State's office, is getting the government out of the way so that people can pursue their American dream. And when we can do that, Americans for Prosperity did a nationwide study and found streamlining licensing could create 2.5 million jobs nationwide. Now, if that just brought 50,000 jobs to Georgia, I know people are pretty excited about 50,000 jobs coming from Amazon. What if we could do that without writing a check for $10 billion or picking winners and losers in our country?
Development, obviously, quick licensing is very important. And like I just said, I think there is a part for technology, but so much of that is just working with your people. You think about that place that sells a chicken sandwich. They're high school kids just like all the other places do, and yet what they do is they run a really tight operation, and it's just training and coaching those people, and they just get great customer service. And that's what we need to do as Secretary of State, so you do get your license turned around quickly. And that's also going back to the securities and encouraging, really. We have health IT. We are one of the leaders in America with health IT and health innovation. What we've done with COVID and Georgia Tech is absolutely amazing. We need to leverage that and have more security investment here in Georgia. When we do that, we'll actually have more corporations that stay here, and that when they get a certain size, they don't actually move out of state or end up getting gobbled up from someone out of state that has been financed by Wall Street. And so I think it's very important that we have a stronger financial industry in Georgia. Thank you.
Best thing that we can do for Georgia from an economic development standpoint has nothing to do with the size of the house we've been talking about today. We've been talking about half the job. Elections, corporations, securities, licensing, charities, boxing commissioner. But the other side of the job is leadership. And that's what's happened in the city of Alpharetta. The reason the city of Alpharetta has the success story it has is not because one person decreed it from the dais, not because our city administrator said it should be. It's because we led. We led leaders. We cast a vision that other people could get behind, and that's what led to growth of over 640 technology companies, over 100,000 jobs in the city of Alpharetta alone, a reinvented downtown, Avalon coming out of the dirt. All the things that have happened in Alpharetta have been through that type of leadership. When you look at the state of Georgia, the best thing that we can do from an economic development standpoint is not hire an administrator to run the Secretary of State's office. We need to elect a leader, someone who knows how to accomplish goals that are beyond the authority and the responsibilities of that office. Thank you.
It's now time for our closing remarks from each candidate. Again, you have 1 minute, and we'll begin with Mr. McKoon.
Thank you for the opportunity to be here this evening. There are three questions you need to answer in deciding who your nominee is going to be. Can they do the job? In my private practice as a lawyer, I've dealt with corporations and elections division. I've handled election contest cases. I've handled ballot access cases. As a member of the state senate, I've dealt with regulated industries and licensed professions. I'm ready to do this job on day one. The second question is, can your candidate defeat John Barrow in the November general election? The Democrats are coming for this office. They're going to spend a lot of money to get there. I've put together a statewide campaign. I'm supported by 21 members of the state senate, including my friend Senator Lindsey Tippins, Cobb County Sheriff Neil Warren, Insurance Commissioner Ralph Hudgens. I've been endorsed by the Georgia Republican Assembly. We're ready to go. We're ready to go in the November election and defeat John Barrow. The third question you need to answer, can you trust the person to do what they tell you they're going to do? Ask someone who followed me through the fight on ethics reform if I do what I tell you I'm going to do. Josh McKoon for Secretary of State.
I'm glad the issue of leadership came up. In 1988, I formed a corporation with a partner, and I bought out his interest when he had failing health. I built that company up to 175 people, so I've set the leadership, I've set the vision for that company. And I can do the same for the Secretary of State's office. One of my employees once said, Brad, you've got so many ideas, I can't keep up with you. So that'll be the challenge that I might have as Secretary of State. As a registered professional engineer, I understand licensing, and I understand how important it is. As an elected public servant, I have never voted for a tax increase, never. I'm the only one on this stage here that is 100% rating from the Faith and Freedom Coalition of Georgia. I'll protect the Second Amendment, I'll protect personhood. It just comes to me natural, that's what I believe in. I will fight to make sure that only Americans vote in our elections, and I'll make sure that Georgia's a great place to find a job and a great place to build a business. And I'm Brad Raffensperger, and I'm asking for your vote on the May 22nd primary. Thank you.
I just want to point out what I'm not running for, why I'm not running. I'm not running to be, even though I am an attorney, I'm not running to be an election attorney for the Secretary of State's office. I'm not running to be an administrator to make the Secretary of State's office just a little bit more efficient or just a little bit more secure in our voting. I'm not even running for the Secretary of State's office to make a better Secretary of State's office for Georgia. That'll happen. I'm running to make a better Georgia through the Secretary of State's office. We have three legislators. We've got one mayor. We've got one executive who knows how to accomplish things that are beyond the authority and the resources of that office. When it comes to John Barrow, I've raised twice as much as anybody on this stage. John Barrow has raised just a little bit more than me. But if we're going to be able to beat John Barrow, it's not about rattling sabers behind a bank of microphones. It's going to be about being able to lead a vision and cast a vision that is bigger than an office, because it's not just about defeating voter fraud. It's also about championing Georgia jobs, and I hope you'll sing that anthem with me. Thank you. Again, it's an honor to be here tonight. Thank you, Kyle, for asking these great questions, and thank all of you for being here. My name again is Buzz Brockway, and I'm asking for your vote for Secretary of State. You know, there's a lot of folks who look at the Office of Secretary of State as a stepping stone to something else or something to do to buy the time until another election comes up and they can run for other offices. That's not why I'm running for this office. I want to do the job of Secretary of State. I'm nerdy enough to care about how long election lines are on election day. I'm nerdy enough to care about how long it takes for somebody to start a business in this country or in this state or get a professional license. And you know, one of my favorite movies is the movie Braveheart. And there's a great line in there, I think, that speaks to our political time. William Wallace looks at the Scottish nobles and says, "You think that the people exist to provide you with a position, but I think your position exists to provide people with freedom." And more than anything else, why the Office of Secretary of State exists is to protect your freedom, whether it's through elections or whether it's through professional licensing. And I'll wake up every day and I'll remember that and I'll work to protect your freedom. Thank you.
Please join me in thanking all of our candidates here for a great day. I've done a lot of these. I don't think I've ever done one before tonight where I didn't have to award a rebuttal time, so it's nice and clean. Quick plug in my new job that I started today at the Georgia Public Policy Foundation. Based right here in Cobb County. Next Thursday, the 19th, we have two of your favorite conservative commentators coming to talk about their book, End of Discussion. That's Mary Catherine Hamm and Guy Benson. You can sign up at georgiapolicy.org. Thank you for having me tonight.
And folks, don't forget the straw poll. How about a hand of a round of applause for our candidates and for our moderator, Kyle Wingfield. I say good job, Kyle. Thank you very much. Very professional and well done. We'll do the straw poll now, and Tanya Ditty, our secretary. A round of applause for our secretary, Tanya Ditty, and our assistant secretary, Kaaryn. Outstanding job of setting up this event. Our volunteers will now come to the stage to get the ballots. Okay, so we're asking everyone to stay seated for the straw poll. If you want to participate in the straw poll, make sure your voice is heard. Stay seated. If you go out to the door, you're not going to participate in the straw poll, folks. Michael McNeely, outstanding job. Are you going to participate in the straw poll, sir? Thank you. So everyone, yes, sir. She's handing out the ballots right now. Thank you very much. You're able to mark one and only one candidate for your choice. If you mark it more than one, you'll be disqualified. That ballot will be disqualified. There's ladies with baskets at the door, so after you make your choice and you walk through the door, you can drop your ballot at the basket. We're going to have a member from each campaign is invited to be present during the tabulation, and the results will be known shortly after that. You also can get the results online at our website, www.gagop6.org. Yes, the ballots, after you've marked your single ballot, you can, on the way out the door, there's baskets held by volunteers. Drop it in the basket.
Get one. Did y'all get one?
Once again, the website, if you want to find the results later tonight, is gagop6.org. That's GAGOP, the number 6.
Jason,
thank you.
Really turned out.
Yeah, exactly. Upper Illinois is also available for.
That's awesome.
Do you want to?
Short conversation.
Okay. Yep. Just waiting to turn it in.
Thanks. I'd also like to thank our volunteers and officers, John Rowe, D-Gay, Nate Porter.
You got your ballot.
I said thank you, Darryl.
I got it right now.
I'm
getting ready to go drop it off.
And I said to them, I said, do you think
you
should
have
enough
money
to...
What do you need me to do? Help clean up? I'm going to drop my ballot off and then I need whatever you need.
What's that?
Oh, good. I'm glad you all enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Yeah,
really good. Really good.
Hey, Nydia.
I had a couple of other people.
I think we have it. I hope it's not being stuck.
A couple other people also commented.
Well, folks, also there is the 6th District's next event is April 21st, the Republican Roundup Barbecue at Roswell Activity Center, Saturday, April 21st. That's followed by the Lieutenant Governor's Award on May 10th at Mount Vernon Presbyterian School in San Francisco.
How are you?
Linda Ben.
How are you doing?
Repeat the results of the straw poll, please.
Yeah, so the results.
Yes, we're listening.
For the straw poll,
Roger.
135 votes cast, 73 for Josh McKoon, 42 for David Belle, 10 for Buzz Brockway, 8 for Brad Raffensperger.
Thank you.
Oh, 50 pounds.
It's 133 total.
Thank you. Thank
public
you.
Public math never works. All right, that's
yeah,
it.
So,
thank you.
Yeah, I'm excited.
All right.
Yeah, you know, when Brian first took office, in fact, so many people were here. Woo!
Thank you.
Thank you.
She's only 22. It's great.
Yeah, I'm sure.